see everybody here, and it's all about Jesus. That's what Christian life is all about. Jesus-sizing everything. Isn't that right? Amen. A few things to keep in mind. We've got a women's retreat coming up on May 13th and May 14th. It's an overnight retreat just for the ladies, and all expenses paid. If you want to stay overnight, just tell Victoria or just show up on Saturday. We've got,
Tell Christine.
Well, tell Christine. Okay. Very good. Christine's in charge. We've got a couple of walks to Emmaus coming up. The men's walk to Emmaus happens to be that same weekend in May, the 13th and 14th and 15th. So think about that. And then we've got the women's walk to Emmaus the following weekend that Cheryl and I are involved in. There's a few ladies from the gathering going to that. So think about going to that for spiritual nourishment as well. So a lot of good things happening that you can take advantage of through the gathering as well. We also have any other announcements? Sir?
Yes. Good morning.
Good morning.
As intergenerational coordinator, this year we are going to the zoo. It's going to be June 18th. It's a Saturday. I think it's the day before Father's Day, I think. I encourage you all to come, bring your kids, bring your grandkids, bring a neighbor, somebody who, you know, you just really like to show a good time to. It's no cost to you. The gathering picks it up. It's a fun, fun event, and I just invite you all to come. I am going to start a sign-up sheet next week, and I really encourage you to sign up because I can buy discounted tickets and try to finagle some free parking passes by buying things in advance. So she will be out there next Sunday. I will remind you every week to sign up. It's all about saving a buck. How are you doing?
Amen. You said you're the best finagler.
Sorry, I'll take that.
She's the best.
Thanks.
Any youth announcements, Quinn?
Yes, actually.
Stuff for the youth. You want to introduce your beautiful girlfriend?
Hi, Brianna.
And of course, keep in mind that on the 15th of this month, Quinn will be speaking, so it's going to be nice.
I make an announcement?
Yep.
If you don't have anything to do this afternoon, there's an American Heritage concert at the Maple Street Chapel in Lombard that I'm playing in, and the money goes to help preserve that chapel. So if you've ever been in downtown Lombard, there's that gorgeous white chapel on Main Street. That's where the concert is, and that's what we're helping preserve. So it's really beautiful, and it's a really fun concert, and we honor our veterans, one of whom will be Ray in the audience, and he'll stand up during the concert when we honor him. So if you want to come, I think it's $20 a ticket at the door. It's a really good, fun concert, and maybe it's about 2 hours, but it starts at 3 p.m.
Thank you. And we've got birthdays.
Two birthdays.
Got two birthdays for your boys.
She's pretty bad there, though.
That's all right. Christine, Bob, and we've got Cher. Raise your hand, Cher.
Raise your hand. Raise your hand.
And we get
Stephanie.
And it's my baptismal birthday.
And it's also baptismal birthday.
And it's both my kids' baptismal birthdays.
Okay, so let's just sing happy birthday to everyone.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The one who loves without distinction calls us here.
From the highest heavens to the deepest ravine,
us into God's future.
From the rising sun to the waning moon, let all creation praise the Lord.
The one who loves us calls us still.
From the new heaven and the new earth, let all creation praise the Lord.
Let us pray.
Wipe away our tears, O God, for we are weary of weeping and the injustices of the world. Love us like a mother, and protect us like a father, that we may live as your beloved children in a world made new. Dwell among us, we pray, that we may love one another as we are meant to love. Amen.
Please remain standing for the opening song.
This happened three times. Then everything was pulled up to heaven. At At the very moment, three men sent to me from Caesarea arrived at the house where we were. The Spirit told me to go with them and not to make a distinction between them and us. These six brothers also accompanied me, and we entered the man's house. He told us how he had seen the angel standing in his house and saying, "Send to Joppa and bring Simon, who is called Peter. He will give you a message by which you and your entire household will be saved." As I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell upon them, just as it had happened, just as it had upon us at the beginning. And I remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said, "John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." If then God gave them the same gift that he gave us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could hinder God? When they heard this, they were silenced, and they praised God, saying, "Then God has given even to the Gentiles the repentance that leads to life." The second reading is from Revelation. "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them, they will be his peoples. God himself will then be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away.' And the one who was seated on the throne said, 'See, I am making all things new.' Also he said, 'Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true.' Then he said to me, 'It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, and the end. To the thirsty I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life. Those who conquer will inherit these things, and I will be their God, and they will be my children.'" This ends the readings. Please stand for the gospel.
Thank you. The Holy Gospel is from John 16. "I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth. For he will not speak on his own, but he will speak whatever he hears, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. For this reason I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you. A little while and you will no longer see me, and again a little while and you will see me." Then some of his disciples said to one another, "What does he mean by saying to us, 'A little while you will no longer see me, and again a little while and you will see me'? Because I'm going to the Father," they said, "what does he mean by this 'a little while'? We do not know what he is talking about." Jesus knew that they wanted to ask him, so he said to them, "Are you discussing amongst yourselves what I mean when I said, 'A little while, and you will no longer see me, and again a little while, and you will see me'? Very truly, I tell you, you will weep and mourn, but the world will rejoice. You will have pain, but your pain will turn to joy. When a woman is in labor, she has pain because her hour has come. But when her child is born, she no longer remembers the anguish because of the joy of having brought a human being into the world. So you have pain now, but you will see again, and now your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take your joy from you." The Gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You can see them. Last Sunday, I was on the phone with somebody that a young man that I had spent time talking to on Saturday as well. So again, this conversation kind of continued on Sunday. And so I was dealing with the whole struggle about how much time to spend with this young gentleman on the phone. And instead of I-sizing it, I Jesus-sized it, okay? And the difference between I-sizing and Jesus-sizing is that I-sizing is only concerned about me, myself, and I, and my time, and my effort, and what I'm putting into all this. It's all about me. But as soon as you Jesus-size something, it becomes much bigger. And there's another agenda involved, and it's not just yours. I-sizing has a tendency to limit the Holy Spirit and its capability to work in a situation, whereas Jesus-sizing opens up the situation to the Holy Spirit. So I decided, you know, to Jesus-size the situation and spend a little bit more time with this young man talking about something that we had gone over before. And finally, he ended up being the one to say, well, Pastor Dawson, I got to go now. Okay? How cool is that? But you see what I'm talking about? If I would have nipped it in the bud according to my agenda, who knows? I might have limited God's capability and ability to work in the situation, and that's what it's all about. Every word, every text, every email ought to be about how God can further his kingdom. So be careful what you do, what you say, and what you send. Okay. So that was Sunday. And then on Monday, I had an appointment with a gentleman named Mike from St. Charles who had quote-unquote hired me to do a wedding for him on May 27th. And I was supposed to meet him at 5:30 at the Starbucks at the corner of 59 and 64. And then he texted me a couple hours before the appointment and said, Pastor Dawson, I won't be there at the appointment because we have found somebody else to do our wedding who we consider to be more appropriate. So I'm not quite sure what that meant. But anyway, you know, I could have I-sized it. I would have I-sized it. Man, just ripping him with a text, you know, how dare you. But again, I Jesus-sized it. I said, Mike, sorry to hear. Thanks anyway. I appreciated the opportunity. That's all I, you see what I'm saying? That's a whole different ballgame. And the fascinating thing is that if I were to isocize that text, it would have held on to me. Remember, anything you isocize starts to burden you and not the person you send it to. You know what I'm talking about? So by Jesus-sizing the text, I liberated myself from the situation and, in a sense, allowed God to take care of it in his own wonderful way. And I went home and did some yard work, which I needed to do. So praise the Lord, you see? Every day you have choices about whether you're going to isocize or Jesus-size. And so on Tuesday, I had two appointments at a Starbucks on Ogden there in Downers Grove, their main street there. And one was at 5:30 and one was at 6:30 with a couple, two couples that wanted to get married. This is all through my pastor on call. And the first couple at 5:30, fantastic. Just a great couple. You could tell that they really knew what was going on, that there was kind of a healthy relationship there. You know, and I ask all sorts of questions, which I have to, you know, how long, you know, are your parents alive? Do you have siblings? And I need to know some of this stuff, which is part of the process. And then the second couple came in at 6:30, and I could tell right off the bat that there was a little tension there. She seemed a little tense, and he seemed like he was just angry from the moment he sat down. I don't know why. You know, and as soon as I started asking him some basic questions, you know, about his age, his occupation, does he have any siblings, are his mom and dad alive, are they divorced, whatever, this. And I could sense the anger. You know, I've been around long enough to know that for some reason he felt uncomfortable. So I had the choice of whether I was going to isocize this situation and tell him to grow up. You see what I'm saying? Or you better get, you better deal with your anger, dude, before you get, but instead, I Jesusized it. I made it a point to just relax and focus on the way that I talked and what I asked and how I handled myself to slowly maybe get him to let his guard down a little bit. You see? So that maybe God can start working. Don't ever underestimate the possibility that this might be the first time in years that God may start working in his life as a result of my interaction with him. If I would have Isis-ized it, that door would have been closed. But I Jesus-ized it. And maybe through me, the Holy Spirit starts to work on his heart a little bit, you know? But he was like this for most of the time. But by the end of our conversation, his hands had dropped. And that's a major body language that said that he felt a little bit relaxed. Some of the anger. I mean, a little segue here about this to this. I remember a lady at Lutheran Church of the Master whose husband never came to church. Pastor, what am I going to do? Just keep praying. Pastor, what am I going to do? Just keep praying. And finally, he ends up in church. And for 2 months, he sat in church like this. And then, after 2 months, one Sunday, I look back, and he's like this. Isn't that amazing? All the time, he thought he was in control, but the Spirit was working on him so that he went from this to this. God had circumcised his heart and took some of that hardness away, and he didn't even know it. God was doing major surgery in his heart, and he still thought he was in control, you see? That's how God works. So this guy was down here by the end of the conversation, so I thought that was pretty cool. And then on Wednesday, I was teaching, and I was supposed to go to one school, but as a substitute, you know, anything can happen. So I ended up going to like 3 different schools that day, all for this like gifted program that I was substituting for. But I remember, you know, I started at Gary, then I went to Courier, and then I ended up at Pioneer. And it was at Pioneer, and it was all 5th grade classes. And at Pioneer, I was supposed to read a book for the teacher called Aunt Harriet and Her Underground Railroad in the Sky. It was kind of a fantasy, real type of story about Harriet Tubman and the Underground Railroad. And I'll tell you, it was kind of a goofy story. But anyway, it's about 2 kids who see this railroad in the sky with the conductor as Aunt Harriet. And they get on board. And by getting on board, they start experiencing what the slaves went through the Underground Railroad many years ago. And crazy stuff. But anyway. But, by the way, she's going to be on the $20 bill for now. Isn't that cool? Yes. So, but anyway, Aunt Harriet kept telling CC and BB, who was the boy and girl, that anytime, you know, you need a little word to get in someplace, like a little clue, you just start singing the song, Go Down Moses into Pharaoh's Land. Just start singing that song, and usually it'll get you to where you need to go. And so one of the kids said, what's this Go Down Moses all about? Well, if I had Isis-ized the situation, it would have been, oh man, I better be careful, I gotta be polite. But you know what? It was a legit, you know, after this movie, God is not dead too, you know. But I Jesus-ized it. I simply talked about, you know, Moses and God's chosen people in the book of Exodus. That's all I said, and how he was a leader who liberated, just like Harriet Tubman, the slaves from bondage. And I said, that's why they sang the song, Go Down Moses. It just reminded people about God's liberating power working through one person to get people out of bondage. And so some of the kids were smiling, and some had no clue what I was talking about, you know, but that's okay. Maybe I sparked a little interest. You see what I'm talking about? Everything you say and do can be an opportunity for God to work through you. Everything. And of course, on Thursday, Prince died. I mean, he was a great musician, so we listened to the radio all day about Prince. And believe me, there are people who have princessized their lives. That's who they honor, isn't that right? That's their God. You think I'm kidding? That's, yeah. Some people have princessized their life. And, you know, and so I'm thinking to myself, yeah, well, Prince, you know, he did revolutionize music. But, you know, who's going to remember Prince 2,000 years from now like we remember Jesus? Nobody, okay? I don't care who you are. And, you know, yes, Prince did contribute to the music industry, but he made millions of dollars doing so. But here's Jesus revolutionizing human history, human nature, the world, giving us a brand new nature, the Holy Spirit, the gift of faith, eternal life, and he asks for nothing in return. You see what I'm talking about? So who am I going to follow? You know, Prince or Jesus? You'd be surprised how many people follow idols of this world. And yet they have so much in Jesus that's free of charge and can benefit them in ways that they can't fully understand. That's where you and I come in, to let people know that there's things beyond Prince in this world. Nothing wrong with Prince, you know, Doug is, but there's something beyond. See? And then on Friday, Linda and I set a new record for orders. Yes, we did 65 orders, which is a lot. And our old record was 64. I don't care what your job is. Your job is your ministry. I don't care what it is. Your job is to do the best you can with what God has given you in the hours of your job. I'm serious. In honor to honor God's kingdom, to do the best you can with what God has given you. Instead of complaining all the time, do your job. And do it to the best of your abilities, because that's a gift from God. So that's what we did on Friday. Isn't that great? My hand was actually a little sore. Man, awesome. You keep pushing that button, you know? And then on Saturday, I had the opportunity to do a graveside service for a wonderful woman named Ruby. I didn't know her. It was through Patterson Funeral Home in Briarwood, but they needed a pastor on call up there at Bluff City Cemetery, which is a beautiful cemetery that exists just south of Lake Street on Bluff City Road. It's part of Elgin, owns a cemetery. Gorgeous place, hilly, trees. And so, you know, I did a little graveside service, and she was buried right next to her husband. And they talked a little bit about who she was, a wonderful, caring person. But I noticed that the grave digger was there, kind of a nice, tall-looking African-American man, had a nice cap on there that said, I've worked 30 years at Bluff City Cemetery. So I said, are you retired? He says, yeah, I'm officially retired, but I come here every weekend to help him out. So he's the one who dug the grave and got all things set up, so it was kind of cool. I asked him a few things about the cemetery. But after the service, you know, I went up to him and I said, hey, my name's Eric. And he said, my name's Charles. And I said, you know what, Charles, you did a great job here, and I want to thank you on this beautiful day. And I said, you know what, I may never see you again, but I'll see you in the world beyond. And he said, amen, brother. So we had a little conversation right there, just Charles and I, about, you know, what, how eternal life is such a fantastic thing to look forward to, and how it affects how you live your life. Just Charles and I just chat a little bit. That's Jesusizing, folks. That's Jesusizing. I could have Isisized the whole thing and just kind of left as soon as I got my check, and who cares, you know? But I stuck around, and for some reason, God said, speak to this guy, and you never know. And so I said to him, I said, yeah, Christ is going to come again, and you better watch out. The Cubs are winning, and if they win the World Series, you know what's going to happen. He started laughing and said, yeah, you never know, brother, you never know. So in our gospel lesson for today, Jesus is talking about the second coming. wow, you know, maybe he is going to come when the Cubs win the World Series. I don't know. It's as good as any other theory. But anyway, and, you know, he's kind of talking to his disciples, and they want to know the particulars. You know, what's a little while? Give us a date and time, Jesus. You know, how we always want particulars. We want to put it in our watches, so we want to set our watch. God doesn't work that way. You know, we always want particulars so that we can use those particulars to, but faith is not all about particulars. Faith is about trusting in the Lord and how he works in wondrous, beautiful, sometimes general ways. And see how Jesus said,
yeah, I know you guys want the particulars, but I ain't going to give you the particulars. You'll know when it's time. Isn't that what he said? It's like a woman giving birth. You know when it's time. And you'll go through some difficulties, and then in the end result, you'll be okay. If Jesus ever wanted to talk about particulars, he always did it in parabolic form. He always told a parable, because the beautiful thing about a parable is you can talk about a particular, but it had a multitude of ways of being interpreted by a multitude of different people. He kind of avoided particulars because he knew that we as human beings like to take particulars, and then we use our particulars to isocize. We always isocize. He didn't want the disciples to start isocizing that particular day and time. You know, well, I know it better than you do. I'm going to be better ready than you. You see? You see what we do with particulars? That's what's happened to Christendom. We've torn it apart with particulars. We fought amongst ourselves as believers with all the particulars. We sacramentalized it. We've religiousized it. We've denominationalized it. We've theologized it. We've doctrinalized it. We've politicized it. We've socialized it instead of Jesusizing it. It's true, isn't that right? That's why you know who's winning the game. The kingdom of God is wherever God's Holy Spirited presence is recognized, appreciated, and utilized through acts of mercy, love, compassion, and forgiveness. That's what the kingdom of God is. And that's where you and I come in, to further the kingdom of God and nothing else. And that's what Jesus size is all about. It's a hard lesson to learn. Especially if you're like a person like me who likes the particulars. Yeah. Yeah. Particulars are listed in the Acts. Peter comes back to Jerusalem. Oh my God, he's crossed the boundary. Guy's gone nuts. He's socializing and preaching to the scum of the earth. The uncircumcised believers, the non-chosen people. We got a physical sign that says that God loves us more than anybody else. How dare you, Peter, go out and preach the word of God to those unlovable people.
All right? They were ready to string him up. Until he told him how God worked through the power of the Holy Spirit.
He just said, this is how God worked. This is what he showed me.
And after they listened to him talking about how God worked through the Holy Spirit, because he was Jesus-sizing the situation, they all said, this must be a sign from God. We now support the fact that God wants you to go out and preach the word to the uncircumcised. Those people who were ready to string him up had their hearts circumcised by the Holy Spirit. All the word circumcision means is to cut in a circle. And all the dead stuff, you know, like that guy sitting in the pew, all that dead stuff had been cut away, and they didn't even know it. But they supported Peter. He might not have totally agreed with everything, but they were willing to look beyond to a much bigger picture, the kingdom of God. Beyond their opinions, their particulars, their whatever we get bogged down in, to the much bigger picture. And that's what it's all about.
last night we had the privilege, Cheryl and I, to go to dinner with somebody that I've known for over 30 years, who was pretty much there at the beginning of Lutheran Church of the Master when I got there in about 82. You know, and we've seen each other, and he's been in and out of my life over the years, but we've reconnected, and we had a wonderful dinner at his house last night with his beautiful wife. And he goes to a big mega church up north. I've invited him to come, but I don't do much of that. And I don't care. And he doesn't care. It makes no difference. Because we share one thing in common. Our love for Jesus and our desire to further his cause in this world. Regardless of where we go and what we think, I don't care if he's a Democrat or Republican. I don't care what his stance is on particular social issues. I don't care what he might have a doctrinal difference, or who cares? It's when you get bogged down in the particulars that the isocizing starts to happen and we start to separate rather than bind together. You see what I'm talking about? So instead, we had a great conversation about, you know, God working in our lives. And whether he realized it or not, he talked about all the stuff that I talk about. The vertical and the horizontal was there. The stopping the don'ts and getting into the do's. The old nature, new nature. You know, let go and let God, which is a little bracelet reminds me of, that little yellow bracelet. All these things were kind of covered in our conversation anyway. Praise the Lord, isn't that right? And that's what it's all about. Jesusizing every moment, every opportunity, instead of isocizing it to your own little particular ways. Please rise. Lord, we just thank you for giving us the privilege in this country to openly Jesusize without fear and intimidation. Let us do it more often. Take advantage of that opportunity to further your kingdom, your cause, and not our particular agendas. It's your agenda. And our agenda is not necessarily always your agenda. Sometimes it's much bigger than that. And that's what we need to focus on when we Jesusize, to allow you to work through the Holy Spirit. Amen.
as you would have us love. Teach our eyes to see, Holy One, as you would have us see. For we are constantly drawing distinctions that separate others into friends and foes, insiders and outsiders. You would have us love without prejudice. You would have us accept without judgment. You would have us truly learn to love. Make your home among us, that we might be made one and whole. Amen.
The one who made heaven and earth dwells among us to bring us love and life. Let us praise the Lord our God, for the one who loves us is faithful.
Amen.
Sometimes it takes a vision to see the world as God intends it to be. Share God's vision of unconditional welcome and love as we pass the peace of Christ. May the peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Please share the peace with one another.
Such love. Give us that same spirit of openness that we too might discern new directions in our day for your dream to reconcile and heal all of creation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This time, feel free to openly pray or silently to yourself.
Lord, I lift up Lottie. I hope that her test today will be and that there won't be anything that's really terribly wrong with her, that she can fix it.
Father, we give you thanks for healing of Victoria's eyes. Give her the strength and the patience she needs to properly heal, Father. For the remaining sight that Mom has, and I ask you to open the eyes of all those who fall short of your Holy Spirit in life.
just to be with Ray and Floyd and Kathy and all those struggling with their continued healing. Be also with Deborah and her sister Brenda. Be with Jim as well, Nicole and Phil. Just be with Diana and Stephanie with their pregnancies and watch over them. All these things we lift up to you in your most precious name. And let's all say amen. Night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples saying, take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And again after supper he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me.
Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Please be seated and come forward at the usher's direction, please.
Thank you.
Christ. Now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ keep you in his love, grace, and truth. Amen.
Jesus has charged us so that we may love others. Go forth in peace to love and serve God.
We will go. Amen.
Faith, hope, love, and justice. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.